Hello Internet, welcome to another tutorial in the series of electromagnetics and antennas. We'll discuss Dolph Tchebyschev array today. This antenna array design is presumed to be the toughest of all the antenna arrays that we design. The reason being a lot of mathematics is involved, and the nature of Dolph Tchebyschev array is such that the amplitudes are distributed in such a way that it needs really hard computations and calculations. But nevertheless, we'll sort this thing out in this video. We'll solve a short numerical in this one, and in the next video I will solve a 9-element Dolph Tchebyschev array. Now please understand, Dolph Tchebyschev array is a linear in-phase antenna array. So if I was to write a few key points about Dolph Tchebyschev array and how do you differentiate it from a binomial or a broadside array, the first point here is that it is a linear and in phase antenna array. Now this point is super important to understand, that the distance between the elements in a Dolph Tchebyschev array is going to be the same. For example, of designed a even sources and an odd sources Dolph Tchebyschev array, you can see the distance between them is the same. So if I was to label the distance, it will be d, which will be some function of lambda. It does not matter as of now, but it is uniform. But the phase is the same. There is no phase difference given as an input to the elements. So the first point is super important. The second point here is that, so in other words, the binomial array used to distribute the magnitudes of the elements in the form of Pascal's triangle. So if we draw Pascal's triangle, so if we were to design a 4-element array, the distribution of magnitudes will be 1 is to 3 is to 3 is to 1. For example, the elements in the center would have 3 times the magnitude as compared to the elements in the corner. But one good thing about binomial array was that no side lobe was produced. So it used to be a very highly directional antenna array which had no side lobes. But when we increase the number of elements, you saw that the magnitude of the element in the center used to become very, very, very large as compared to the magnitude of the elements at the edges. So to avoid that, or to solve that problem, we have migrated ourselves to Dolph Tchebyschev array. Now in Dolph Tchebyschev array, we'll have the ratio of the magnitudes to be very, very small. In other words, the elements in the center would have comparable magnitudes as compared to the elements at the edges, but the trade-off there would be the side lobes. You're gonna find very small side lobes in Dolph Tchebyschev array. Now the power or the magnitude of these side lobes is going to be very, very, very small. So, and that is what I'll explain you in this tutorial as to how you can find that. So in Dolph Tchebyschev array, you'll be asked to design a Dolph Tchebyschev array where the side lobe levels are 19.1 dB down the main lobe. So in other words, the resultant radiation pattern would have a side lobe present, but that side lobe will be 19.1 dB down. So it is very, very, very small as compared to the energy of the main lobe. You need to design such an array whose radiation pattern looks like this, and then you'll need to find out the ratio of the energies in the elements, and that ratio should come out to be very, very small as compared to what we used to have in the binomial array. Lobe levels will be 19.1 dB down the main lobe for 4-element Dolph Tchebyschev array. Right? So, how do you go about solving and designing such an array? I'll come back to the main page here, where I'll give you a brief idea as to how this all started. A scientist by the name of C.L. Dolph used the Tchebyshev polynomial to design the magnitudes of the elements of the array, and I'll talk about the Tchebyshev polynomial as of now. Tchebyshev polynomial is given by this equation. Now, you need to be very, very conversant with this polynomial when you... So, as you can see, I have derived this polynomial for all the degrees up to 9. So, I have t0x, t1x, t3x, up to t9x. Now, if you look at the equation for Dolph Tchebyshev polynomial, which is cos of m cos inverse x, and if you substitute cos inverse x as delta or phi by 2, which happens to be the phase difference, so a little bit of rearrangement gives you x is equivalent to cos of delta and cos of phi by 2, right? So if you start solving this for all the degrees, the first degree becomes cos of 0, which is 1. The second degree becomes cos of delta, which is x from this equation. From star, you see that cos of delta is x from this assumption. And similarly, cos of 2 delta, now we put m is equivalent to 2, the degree to be equivalent to 2, then we get the polynomial to be equivalent to 2x square minus 1, because if you expand cos of 2 delta, it becomes 2 cos square delta minus 1, which becomes 2x square minus 1, and so on. Now here's what you can do to obtain higher degrees of Tchebyshev polynomial. You could use recursion formula to obtain higher terms. For example, if you were to find out t4x, that is what I've illustrated here. For t4x, what you can do is you need to use previous polynomials tmx and tm1 minus 1x. So using t3x and t2x, I can find t4x. So here I've shown you how you can find t4x. This is t3x, by the way, and this is t2x. And using these two, by putting in this generalized recursion formula, you can find t4 and consequently t5, t6 and up to t9, because if you are to design a Dolph Tchebyshev array of 9 elements or 8 elements or 10 elements, you'll need higher degrees of this polynomial, and there is no way you can cram this or commit to your memory, so you'll need to remember this trick. Now, first thing is sorted out. We have the Tchebyshev polynomial in hand. The next thing is designing of the Tchebyshev array for either even sources or for odd sources. Now, why is it so important to understand that the number of sources are even or odd? It is because of the fact that if the number of sources are even, then please understand the elements at the center, the two elements in the center, will have highest magnitude of energy and they'll be equivalent to A naught. The coefficient, I'll use the coefficient A naught for both of them. And as you move away from the center, you'll find equal number of elements on both the sides. When the number of elements are even, you'll need to assign A naught coefficient to the two centermost elements, and then you'll find equal distribution of A1s, A2s up to the last element. So for example, if we were to draw here in this case, I've drawn an 8 element array. So in 8 element array, we'll have the task of finding A naught, which will be the magnitude of the two center elements, then A1, A2 and A3. So you can see that for even sources, the coefficients that we'll need to find will be half of the number of elements. Now let's look at the case of odd sources. In odd sources, the center element will be left isolated alone because it will have even number of elements on both the sides. The element which is left alone in the center is assigned twice of A naught magnitude. So that's the difference. And then this is the 7 element Dolph Tchebyschev array, and for a 7 element Dolph Tchebyschev array also we'll need to find out A naught, A1, A2 and A3. Alright, now after having understood the relevance, we can always see that the total electric field which is obtained at a distant point from an even sources Dolph Tchebyschev array would be the electric field due to these two plus the electric field due to these two. Now the reason why I'm combining the electric fields of these two is that because they are identical sources of same magnitude, and A1 sources will be identical to each other. So you'll have something like this. So you'll have twice of A naught cos of phi by 2 plus twice of A1 cos of 3 phi by 2. Now this thing is changing because as you move away from the center of the array, the phase difference also increases, because you can see that these two elements, although there was no phase difference from the source, but because of the distance between the elements, the energy reaching at a distant point P will have certain amount of extra length that it has to cover, and that extra length that it will cover puts in some phase difference. So that has already been discussed in the broadside array design. So as we move away from the center of the array, the phase difference also starts to increase because of the distance. So, but the fact here is this 2 that we are using here is the fact that this 2 is being put here is because two elements of same magnitudes are placed at equal distance from the center. So I'll put in twice of A2 cos of 5 by 2, etc. Now, depending upon the number of elements, these terms will increase. And what you need to commit to your memory is that the total electric field due to even elements is given by twice. Now this 2 is taken to be common, and we'll introduce a term K, because this K is the subscript of the coefficients that we need to find. So this will go up to 0 to capital N minus 1, and it will be something like this, where capital N is the number of elements upon 2. Now you will appreciate the fact that if we had 8 elements, then by inspection we knew that we had to find 4 coefficients. So over here also capital N is 4, so we'll need 4 coefficients, we'll find 4 coefficients, and if we start from 0 we'll obviously need to go to N minus 1. So that condition is the only condition that we need to take care, that capital N goes to N minus 1 while we find the number of coefficients in this case. Now for going by the same rule, we need to establish the total electric field for odd element, and that will again be, you know, twice of A naught and twice of A1 plus twice of A2. So I'll write down the final formula, which will be twice of K going from 0 to N this time around, because for 7 elements we need to go to capital N equal N to N naught minus 1 upon 2 on both the sides. So on both the sides, so this will give us 3 elements on both the sides, leaving aside A naught. So we get AK cos 2K phi by 2. So these are the two most important things that you need to remember while designing Dolph Tchebyschev array, that the total electric field due to even elements is 0 to n minus 1 and this, and due to odd is 0 to n this, and that can be easily understood if you draw it and see the distribution. Alright, now once we are through with this part, we get to the steps of and by the way, if we were to use the relative field patterns or the normalized field patterns, then we can omit 2 from here. We can simply use this formula without a 2 if we were to use the normalized electric field, and this is what we are going to implement in the numericals also. Now the step number 1 will be to find the ratio side lobe level ratio. That will be given in the question. For example, we are attempting to do this question where the side lobe level is given 19.1 dB. So when such a thing is given, because the ratio R is equivalent to main lobe maxima upon side lobe level. So if in dBs we'll need to make it as 20 log of 10 R. So with respect to this question, if we were to find the value of R, that will be 19.1 is equivalent to 20 log of R, because this value is in dBs and we are concerned about the ratio of main lobe maxima to the side lobe level. So we get R is equal to 19.1 upon 20, and anti-log of this, and if you solve this, you need to use calculator to solve this, you'd get a value of 9. Now step number 2, we need to find the value of X naught. To find the value of X naught, we need to see what is the degree of Tchebyschev polynomial that we need to use, and the degree of Tchebyschev polynomial that we need to use is M, which is given by the formula n minus 1, where n is the number of elements, and in our case we have a problem of 4 elements array. So my m becomes 4 minus 1 is equivalent to 3, and once we have determined this, we need to look at the third polynomial, third degree polynomial of Tchebyschev, which is 4x cubed minus 3x. So what I'll have here is t 3 of x naught will be equivalent to 4x naught cubed minus 3x naught, and this should be equivalent to 9, which is our ratio. And alternatively, you can find X naught to be equivalent to 1 upon 2 R plus R square minus 1 1 upon M plus R minus R square minus 1 raised to the power 1 upon M. So this is something that you need to commit to your memory to find the value of X naught, and this value of X naught will be used later on to find the coefficients. So if you want, you could pause the video and note this value down, and substituting R is equivalent to 9, which is found in the step number 1, and taking M is equivalent to 3. So we can simply put this value. So the value of x naught will come out to be 1.5. This could be a tedious calculation even on the calculator because of the brackets and the powers in fractions. So be careful while calculating the value of x naught in on calculator. And now the value of x naught has come out to be 1.5. Now the next thing is our step number 3 will be to find array polynomial and array polynomial will be for 4 elements. We know that for 4 elements, which is in case of even, we'll need to assign a naught to the centermost elements and then a1 to the outer elements. So it will become a case of even, and for the case of even we'll go from 0 to 1, right? Because capital N will be 4 by 2 is equivalent to 2, and we go from 0 to capital N minus 1. So in other words, we'll go to K going from 0 to 1. This is capital N. And of course, AK will be found for two values only, from 0. One is for 0 and the other one is for 1. So from the formula that we have committed to our memory here, we have a pretty simple job of finding two coefficients, and we'll do that by expanding this. When you expand this thing, I'll simply write, it'll become a naught z plus a1 4 z cube minus 3 z, where z will be x upon x naught. Now please understand, when you expand this Tchebyschev part of the polynomial, you'll need to substitute it with some variable here, and that variable will be z here, because we are going to substitute x naught here, and then in the next step, by comparing, we'll find out the coefficients. So in the final step, what we'll do is, this is step number 4 and final step, and this step is very, very important. We need to substitute E4z to be equivalent to T3x. Now this is the most important. I'll put a star next to it, that the value of electric field that you have found in step number 3, I'll highlight this with red pen, it goes equivalent to the Tchebyschev polynomial of 1 degree less, because we've used a Tchebyschev polynomial of T3x naught in step number 2. In step number 2, we have mentioned that the degree of Tchebyschev polynomial needs to be m, which is n minus 1. So it will be T3x naught. So what we'll do here is, we'll start writing the left hand side and the right hand side. And substituting z is equivalent to x upon x naught, we get a naught x upon x naught plus a1 4 x upon x naught cube minus 3 x upon x naught. Now this step is very important. On the left hand side and the right hand side, we need to compare the highest order terms. Now if we compare the highest degree of x, the coefficient of highest degree of x, which is 3, the right hand side has 4. And the highest degree of 3 on the left hand side is 4a1 upon x0 cube into x cube. So this is the highest degree of left hand side with a coefficient 4a1 upon x0 cube, and the coefficient of x cube is 4 on this side. And we know x0 is already found to be 1.5 here in step number 2. So I'll substitute x0 as 1.5 cube, and I'll get the value of a1 here, which will be 3.375. Now it's very important to compare the highest order term first, because once you find the highest order term, then you can go ahead and compare the lower order terms and substitute the value of this coefficient there, because in the next step you'll find that a naught z minus 3 z a1 is equivalent to minus 3x. So this is obtained by comparing next highest order term. So substituting z to be equivalent to x upon x naught, over here we'll take help of a1, which is already found, and the value of a0 becomes equivalent to 5.625. Now you can see a1 has a value 3.375 and a0 has a value 5.625. And for a 4 element Dolph Tchebyschev array, we only had to find the values of a0s and a1s. So substituting the value of a0 to be equivalent to 5.625 and 3.375. So a1s are getting this value, a naughts are getting this value. And finally, because we need to express a1s as unities, so the relative amplitudes will become 1.66, 1.66 and 1, which is obtained by simply writing by dividing a1 by all the other elements. So a1 by a1 gives me the relative amplitude of the corner elements, then a0 by a1 gives me the center element, so it is 1.66. so if you have many other elements, you simply need to keep them dividing by the magnitude of the element at the end positions. So final array becomes this. And if you compare, this is the Dolph Tchebyschev array, and if you compare this with the 4-element binomial array, you can see the magnitude of the elements in the center is 1.66. Over here the magnitude of the elements was 3 and 3, which was 3 times the magnitude of the end elements, and we have saved up on a lot of energy, with the exception that some side lobes will appear and the magnitude of those side lobes will be 19.1 dB down the main lobe, which is almost negligible. So I think it's a great bargain to design Dolph Tchebyschev array on top of any binomial array. And I hope this tutorial, this comprehensive tutorial on designing Dolph Tchebyschev array from the Tchebyschev polynomial step by step was of help. If you liked the content of the video, give it a thumbs up, consider sharing and subscribing. That'll be a great help. I'll see you in the next video. Goodbye.